If you would, open your Bibles to the book of Romans, chapter 1. Book of Romans, chapter 1. We're going to be reading from verse 18 to the end of the chapter and verse 32. And we'll jump around to Romans a little bit because I think it's critical as I studied this book and this letter. It's written as a letter to the people in the newly formed Christian church there in the city of Rome. And so it's written as a letter. It's not written just in little bits and pieces. So really to understand it and to grasp what it's all about, you've got to read the whole thing. You've got to see it in context. And I pray that you are doing that even as we go through little bits of it here from Sunday to Sunday during the series. But it's critical because the people that Paul is writing to is this new church, which is comprised of Gentiles who were not religious beforehand, especially when it came to the law, and Jews. There are Jews there too, mostly Gentile. And in this passage, you see, or in this book, the first chapter is written to the Gentiles pretty much. In the second chapter, Paul tells the Jews to listen up as well. But it's written specifically to that church, but it's speaking to all of us. God in His sovereignty put this letter here for us to read this morning and to apply to our lives and to hear from God. And Paul's not necessarily correcting doctrine like he did in a lot of his letters to the different churches spread out, but he's laying the groundwork, the framework, the foundation of the gospel. The righteousness of God, the unrighteous sinfulness of man, God's righteous judgment on sin, and the unmerited, undeserved grace that you and I are privileged to receive through Jesus Christ. And so he lays the groundwork for that. And in this first chapter, it's kind of heavy, but he is doing that, the very foundation of the story of salvation. So it's important as we examine these few verses, it'd be specifically verses 28 through 32. But I want to start in verse 18. And yes, I know we've Pastor Paul has covered these verses, some of those in the past few weeks. But just to get a good context of what Paul is talking about and to see that this is universal, folks. This is not just Jews, not just Gentiles, not just the church at Rome. But for all of us, it's intended for us to hear this morning. And God is speaking. We need a Savior. They needed a Savior. They will need a Savior. All of mankind is in need of a Savior, and we're going to discuss some of that this morning. Let's pray first. Lord God, thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord, that you've not left us alone, but your Spirit is here this morning. Holy Spirit, thank you for your presence. I pray that you would take the word and apply it to our hearts. Draw us to the Father this morning. Realign our priorities and our understanding. God, that we would give you the appropriate place in our lives, and that is on the throne of our lives, the one true living God. May we adjust to you this morning, Lord God. And I pray that as I speak, God, my default a lot of times is just to confuse and redirect and just mess it up, God. And I just pray today that I would decrease and you would increase. God, speak to us through your word, through the power of your Holy Spirit this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, Romans chapter 1, beginning in verse 18. I think the slide probably begins at 28 or something crazy like that. So you can jump in there at 28. But we're going to begin in verse 18 of chapter 1. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world, in the things that have been made, so they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him. But they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. Therefore, God gave them up in the lusts of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason, God gave them up to dishonorable passions, for their women exchanged natural relations for those that are contrary to nature. And the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another, men committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. Now, beginning in verse 28, and since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Though they know God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but give approval to those who practice them. Somebody asked me last week when the service was over, so you're preaching next week, right? Are you going to make us laugh a little bit? Because this is heavy stuff. Have you read this? This is heavy stuff. I want us to look at a couple things Paul says to us in verse 28 through verse 32. Verse 28a, first part of that verse. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, man rejects God. That's it. In our default mode, from the beginning, from the garden, we reject the Creator. Our default mode is to turn from Him and to run from Him. We used to have a Brittany Spaniel, and that little dog, we had a little tiny house, and it was miserable there. And then we'd let it out when we'd go up to the mountains for vacation, and that thing would run. It was born to run. It was in it to run. And we as humans, as all mankind, from the garden, are born with that nature to run from God, to replace God with ourselves as God. The core of this rebellion, all through these passages, is idolatry. There's a list of sins, yes, but idolatry is at the core of it. We as mankind have said, God, we don't want you, we want ourselves on the throne of our lives. In the context of where Paul writes, Rome, I mean, this was the center of Western civilization and culture, impressive structures, monuments, temples, the Great Forum, theaters, the Circus Maximus, where they'd run the chariots around, big, beautiful structures and buildings and tributes to Caesar and Augustus and Nero. There were temples to pagan gods such as Jupiter and Apollo and Venus and Castor and many others. And of course, the great pantheon, the center of pagan worship. Rome loved some Rome. Worshiping accomplishment and leadership and might and knowledge. But it wasn't just the Gentiles there in Rome. Even the Jews that sat in that service, who read that letter, even the Jews from the beginning of time have run from God. The God that delivered them from Egypt, the God that made provision for them, took them out from under Pharaoh's hand, and the God that they saw do miracle after miracle, split the Red Sea wide open. And yet, where do they end up? Around a golden calf, melting down all their possessions, all their gold to worship. Because God just wasn't enough. We know the great civilizations that have come and gone, Greece, worship knowledge, philosophy. It's funny, in that movie, My Big Fat Greek Wedding, we always laugh about it. My wife is partly Greek. Her father came from Greece, and the father in that always says, "You give me any word, and I will show how that word comes from the Greeks. We invented it." Prideful. Accomplishment, knowledge, self, and nothing's changed. Nothing's changed in our world. We celebrate success, fame, fortune, accomplishment, celebrity. Interesting there in chapter 2, just one verse 1 past out of chapter 1, he says, he turns to the Jews and says, "Therefore," to the religious there, "you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges, for in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, practice the very same things." As this list of sins is read off, you can see the religious people standing there saying, "That's right. That's right." Last week, as Pastor Paul talked about sexual deviancy, we may say, "Well, that's not me." But the core of our sinfulness, just as Pastor Paul communicated over and over last week and the week before, is our idolatry. We can tell one another, "Quit doing that," or, "I want to turn over a new leaf this year. I'm going to make a New Year's resolution. I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm going to be better." But the core of it is, God is not on his proper throne in our lives. We all worship something. We're created to worship. Created to worship the one true living God, not ourselves. We are not sufficient gods. And this morning, this is personal for you and I as well. I mean, what is the most important thing? Let me ask you, what is the most important goal, aim, dream of your life this morning? Of your children, for your children even. What is success? If a relationship with your Creator is not at the very top, then it's upside down and it's doomed for disappointment. I got to preach, was asked to preach at my daughter Sophie's baccalaureate service a couple years ago, and I challenged the students there. I said, "How many of you know what you're going to do? You know where you're going to college, and then from then on, you know what you're going to do. Maybe you're going to go to school, maybe where your parents went and their parents went, and then you're going to get a job. Do you know what you're going to do?" I mean, lots of them. I said, "How many of you have asked God, 'God, what do you have for me? What do you want, God, my Creator, the giver of life? What do you want from my life?" Or will we go on with our plans, and then somewhere down the road where everything's a mess, we turn and say, "God, can you clean this up for me? Can you restore these relationships? Can you restore the dream that I once had for life?" God will not take second place. And we have no excuse for not acknowledging God. And Pastor Paul talked about this a little bit, but you can see the Gentiles sitting there saying, "Listen, we're not the ones that had the law. God didn't do all these miracles for us. He didn't give us the law. And we're not the chosen people. So, I mean, how are we supposed to know?" And you may be saying that this morning. You may say, "I didn't grow up in church. I've never heard all this." I mean, there's got to be some weighted scale for those of us, you know, like the man on the island that Pastor Paul was talking about the other day. Bertrand Russell, in the early 20th century, was a mathematician, philosopher, wrote the book, "Why I'm Not a Christian." And someone asked him, he's an atheist, and somebody asked him, "You know, if you were to stand before God, and God, at that moment, he was real, and God said, 'Why didn't you serve me? Why didn't you worship me?'" Russell's answer was, "Not enough evidence, God. Not enough evidence." Well, let's see what God says back in verse 19 of the same chapter, 19 and 20. We read this the other day. "For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world and the things that have been made. So they are without excuse." Creation declares the praise of our God. Creation points to our Creator. Richard Dawkins, hyper arch Darwinism defender, on the front lines of this debate over evolution, he wrote, "Biology is the study of complicated things that have the appearance of having been designed for a purpose." Even he realized, I know it looks one way. Logically, everything points to a creator, but we've got to teach it another way. Francis Crick, the co-discoverer of DNA. What a title. I could use that at my house every now and then. My kids go, "Dad, you just don't get it. You don't know anything." "Oh, yeah? Have you looked at Wikipedia lately? I helped create DNA." Not create it, but discover it. That'd be awesome. But he wrote this: "Biologists must constantly keep in mind that what they see was not designed, but rather evolved." We got to keep telling ourselves that. We got to keep teaching others that, or basically we won't have a job. I remember one day, several years ago, we were going to school, and I was taking the kids to school, and they were teaching evolution. And my daughter asked, "Dad, why would they believe that? Why are they teaching that? Why do they say it's true?" I said, "Well, so we drove by some telephone poles." I go, "How did that telephone pole get there? And there was wires and a transformer. How did that get there?" She's like, "I would guess the electric company put it up." I go, whoa, wait, I'm sorry. I didn't ask the question correctly. Take away the option that it was put there by somebody. "Now, how did that get there?" She went, "I don't know, maybe the storm went through the woods and flipped a branch, a big tree up, and it stood up, and some wires got caught up in some garbage and thrown on there, I guess." That's what we do. That's what we do when we say, "God, you're not an option." And we take science, and Christians, we don't have to run from science. Science just magnifies the beauty of what God has done. Don't let the world steal that from us. God is creator. Everything cries out that he has created everything. But their thinking has been warped. Psalm 14:1 says, "The fool says in his heart, there is no God." All of this evidence, and yet we run and reject him as creator. The bottom line is, we don't want or believe that we need God. We can do it without him. The human default from the garden is to push God out and put ourselves on the throne. So we see first, God runs from God, rejects God. But also, what's the result of that rejecting God? Look in verse 28, the second half of verse 28. "So God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done." God removes the restraints. I think that's one of your blanks. God removes the restraints and gives us over to our sin. There's a wordplay there in the Greek, basically saying man rejected the knowledge of God, so God gave man over to a rejecting mind. Debased. That word's used to describe useless metal that has too many impurities in it, and so it's cast out. It reminds me of when I was a kid. I was thinking about this week, and we'd play hide-and-go-seek in our house, and my older brother, who was 8 years older than me, I would hide, and he would come find me. And so I went into the kitchen, and my mom's there doing something at the sink, and we used to have our dryer and our washer right there in the kitchen, everything right there in the kitchen. And so I went up to the dryer, and I was going to get in the dryer to hide from my brother. And my mom said, whoa. "No, you're not." I said, "Wait, Larry's coming. He'll never find me. He'll never look for me in here." She's like, "Number one, he will find you. I guarantee you, because you don't know how to be quiet. Number two, that's dangerous. You're not getting in there." I said, "Mom, please, he's coming, please." And she was busy. She said, "Okay, fine, whatever, do it." So I climbed in that dryer and shut the door. And a little while later, a few minutes later, I see my brother come by. I had a little glass, window there, and then I saw his legs come back and stand right in front of me, and I was like, "Oh no." And all of a sudden, And my mom had already left the kitchen, and she heard me scream, and she came running back in there. What are you doing? He's like, oh, I didn't know he was in there. And so what, you were doing laundry? My mom already had us figured out. But that's what she did. She let me go. If that's what you want to do, go ahead. Go ahead. And I paid the price for that. Man has rejected the knowledge of God, and so God gave us over to that rebellion. This is the third time he said it. He said in verse 24, therefore God gave them up. Verse 26, for this reason God gave them up. Verse 28, and since they did not see fit, God gave them up. Every time it's a result of idolatry, of man taking God out of his rightful place and putting self. William Barclay says this, not so much God sends judgment on a man as a man brings judgment on himself. Sin judges sin. The wording here is not a reprobate in that God does not abandon man right here as unsavable, but as in giving him over to the consequences of his sin. Because God does restrain evil in the world. There's a thing called common grace, not salvific grace, which is the grace for salvation, but a common grace that God restrains evil in the world. Scripture tells us in Proverbs, the king's heart is a stream of water in the hand of the Lord. He turns it wherever he wills. The psalmist wrote, the Lord brings the counsel of the nations to nothing. He frustrates the plans of the people. God is actively involved in restraining evil. But also he's given us a conscience, an ability to determine right from wrong from the garden. Remember the tree of knowledge of good and evil? And then we have that knowledge of good and evil. And so we have the ability to determine right from wrong. Only humans. I've never seen a lion on the Serengeti or wherever they live feeling so guilty that I've got to stop doing this, killing these hyenas and eating them. This is just wrong. You don't see that in animals. You see that in humans. We have that ability to determine right from wrong. And so in all this, we see we have no excuse, and God has given us over to what we begged for, basically. 1 Timothy says, because of sin, our conscience can be seared as with a branding iron. Numb. We become numb to it. Verse 21 of chapter 1 here in Romans says that they become futile in their thinking. Their foolish hearts are darkened. When God removes his restraint, it's the opposite of Romans 12:2, which says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. That's God's will for us. To be able to determine, to know his will, to have a relationship with him. But when we take him off the throne, we put ourselves on the throne, say, God, I don't need you. He gives us to that, gives us over to that. And then we spiral. We spiral from there. Is God giving up on man? Of course not. Chapter 2, right there, just down a few verses in verse 4 of chapter 2. Paul writes, or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? Paul describes it as God's kindness in an effort to lead you to repentance. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4 says, God wants all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. But he gives us over to those consequences that we might repent. We might see the error of our ways. Parents, if you're parents of teenagers especially, I'm finding this more and more, you do that with your kids. You begin to allow them to feel the weight of their decisions, right? Or is that, am I just mean? Because I start doing that as they get older. The consequences of choices. You forget your lunch money over and over and over again, then sooner or later, I can't just run down to the school every day and bring your lunch money. You got to remember to pick it up. Or as happened in our house, I won't use any names because several of my kids are here. I walked in the house and we were talking about something that needed to get done, and we need, I was asking them to get it done and all these things, and this one child said, well, it just seems like somehow it always gets taken care of. Somehow. I said, now I know I got an S on my chest. I thought that was for Superman, not somehow. I am somehow. It gets done because somehow it gets done. Sooner or later, you've got to take over. But just as a parent does that, God gives us over to the consequences of that sin. So Paul holds up the mirror here and shows us that mankind has rejected God. God, in turn, has given us fully over to that mindset. And the result is this, verses 29 through 32. The fruit of a life that has turned its back on God Almighty. And there's a pretty hefty list there. Evil, covetousness, malice, envy, deceit, murder, strife. We've got murders. I want you to notice, kids, murderers and disobedient to parents are all on that list. All the same. John Piper said, when a society is sinking into moral decay, one of the traits is the inability to see what's happening. That's a dangerous place to be. But it's a natural consequence of turning from God, and we see it everywhere in our society. They saw it everywhere in their society. Foolish hearts darkened. Moral framework God intended, gone. And it's not an exhaustive list here. It's Paul saying, those of you who, when I read those previous two verses about sexual immorality, and you stood back and went, ha, yeah, get them. It's like, no, we're all included in this. We've each turned our back. Each one has sought his own way. And this is the natural consequence. We see it in society, destruction of the family, abortion, sexual deviance, race relations, crime, every moral failure that we're experiencing, the high crime rate, crooked politicians, it all goes back to idolatry. We've put God off the throne and put ourselves on the throne. We could talk about the individual sins all day, and they all offend God and make us his enemies. But the bottom line is we've removed God and put ourselves there. And as a society, we will continue to spiral. And as a believer, you will continue, if you speak the truth, to be more and more outside of the norm of society. But also, this is not a societal statement or even a political one. It's for individuals as well, for you and me. We look at our neighbors and our family members, depression, drug addiction, suicide, divorce, loneliness, dissatisfaction. We are not sufficient gods. And when we remove the influence of God Almighty from our lives, from our families, we reap the benefits of that, the consequences. Because that void is not filled. And ultimately, if we die that way, he says they refuse to acknowledge God as God. If you die in that condition, God will give you what you want. We'll be separated. You will be separated from God for eternity. And people say, well, how can a good God? That's not fair. That's what we asked for. Scripture describes that as God saying on the last day, depart from me, I never knew you. Or enter, good and faithful servant. That day is coming. And so it's not just the temporary consequences of this life, but there's an eternity at stake. And it's too easy to go through this first chapter of Romans, which I have done many times, and just stand back and say, wow, man, those people were messed up. He's speaking to us today, to you, to me. So there it is. Hopeless, rebellious condition of every person since the Garden of Eden. Jews, Gentiles, Arabs, Americans, white, black, poor, rich, criminals, religious. Every person that can hear my voice this morning. Enemies of the Most High God because we refuse to acknowledge Him as God on our own. But God all week long, I've been digging through this. Man, this is a tough chapter of Scripture. I stop about halfway through and say, okay, I gotta put grace in here. I gotta start talking about. And God stopped me over and over again. Finish it. Say the sins. Talk about the darkness that is there. Because I am God, I'm on my throne, and man has rejected me and rebelled against me. And we need to tell the world what the condition is. Church, we need to know that's the condition of our neighbors and our friends, of our family members. That's the condition, not all the little sins that we're scared to say something about or something at Thanksgiving or whatever. No, it's direct rebellion, idolatry, and we know it. They know it. What is the light without the darkness? We don't offer a God who just is going to make things perfect in your life as far as you're concerned, make you successful. God's not about the American dream. God is about holiness. God is about God. And He created us to be about God. When you're making your plans, when we're making our dream list, when we're trying to figure out what it is we want to do with our lives or what do we want for our kids, our Creator stands with open arms to a rebellious people all day long. That's what He says in His Word. God created us for a relationship with Him. If you're here this morning, listen, I know it's heavy, but this is good news. We've got good news for you this morning. But God, Romans chapter 5, but God, verse 8, shows His love for us. This is the remedy. This is the answer. But God shows His love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by His blood, Christ died for us. Much more shall we be saved by Him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of His Son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by His life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through Jesus Christ, from whom we have now received reconciliation. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, that a rebel like me who ran from God, tried to shake the things that I learned as a child, shake them off, numb it. God had mercy on me. And God offers mercy to you this morning. Romans 3:23 says, listen, this is the gospel. If you're here this morning and you don't have a relationship with God, this is it right here. Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23, a couple of chapters later, says, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 says, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. Acts chapter 3, verse 19. Repent, therefore, and turn back that your sins may be blotted out. That is good news this morning, folks. All of that is true. We have turned our backs on God. We have rebelled against Him as a people, as a humankind. The Bible says we're enemies of God, but God in His great mercy has given us the remedy, and that is Jesus Christ, His Son, went to the cross, died, paid the price for our sin. I know it's more than you can comprehend completely, but it's true. And we can have a right relationship with our Creator this morning through Jesus Christ. Believers, how should we respond to this? Number one, it should transform our worship. I'm not just saying that because I'm the music guy. It should transform our worship, just personal worship, our reading scripture, our prayer life. Yes, singing. I mean, just to be reminded when we come in here on Sunday and I'm reminded of who God is and what He's done and who I am. I wish God would let me go from that sometimes, but it's fresh. He won't. He keeps it fresh in my heart and my mind that I was a sinner, a rebel. I was doing life my way. I had the answers. I knew what I wanted to do. I had my own plans and my own goals. But I was empty. And God, in His mercy and His grace, sent someone to tell me, like I'm telling you today, God loves you and gave His Son for you. And in Christ Jesus, He doesn't just make you better. He's not going to clean you up. He changes you forever. But we don't come to Him and say, God, I need all these things. We come to Him in humble repentance and say, God, I agree with You. I agree. I've turned my back on You. And what I thought was ignorance even. I didn't know and I didn't think I knew. But I am a sinner. I'm convicted by Your word. I am a sinner and I need a relationship with You. I need You, oh God. I receive the gift of Jesus Christ who died for my sins. And I want You to be my Lord. Please take my life. He will make you new. I'm here this morning to testify. I've been there. He did it. And He will do it today. Believer, our worship should be transformed. Thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. That's worth celebrating. Amen. But also the man on the island. You know, we talked about the man on the island, and I've had that conversation before with people. What about the guy on the island who's never heard? And nobody, and I know Pastor Paul went all the way through this, but what God laid on my heart this week as I was thinking about that. You are the answer to the man on the island. All of us gathered up in here this morning. We're the answer for the man on the island. We can't stand and shake our fist in the face of God and say, that's not fair. What's not fair? That you won't go? That I won't go? That's not fair? When He gave His Son, when He gave everything for us? Yeah, but God, You ought to reach them without upsetting my world. That's God's plan. He upsets worlds. Praise Him for that. J.D. Greer wrote a book called Gaining by Losing. Here's a quote from it I just thought was awesome. He speaks about, in chapter 1 of Romans there, we went over this a few weeks ago, but chapter 1, verse 14 says, Paul says this, I am under obligation both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to the wise and to the foolish. So I am eager to preach the gospel to you also who are in Rome. J.D. Greer says this, every person who knows and understands the gospel is under this same debt obligation. As David Platt says, every saved person this side of heaven owes the gospel to every unsaved person this side of hell. If you are saved, you are under obligation to, and I love this phrase, leverage your life to bring salvation to the nations. Those of us called to be leaders in the church are under obligation to train you up and send you out. We pastors are not free to build ministries that mainly make life more comfortable for all of us. Each of us is under obligation to do whatever we can to get the gospel to those all around the world who have never heard. They are many. And we are called, we are under obligation to take the gospel, because we've not earned it. It's been given to us. It is unmerited and undeserved. But the fact that we're sitting here this morning and we've heard it and we've received it is only by God's grace, and we ought to share that. So, in conclusion, Matthew chapter 25. And listen, this is a little bit heavy to end on, but Matthew 25, verse 31 through 34. This is a picture, let me just say this first. This is a picture of a day that is coming, as sure as we are sitting here this morning. When the Son of Man comes in His glory, and all the angels with Him, then He will sit on His glorious throne. Before Him will be gathered all the nations. And He will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And He will place the sheep on His right, but the goats on His left. Then the king will say to those on His right, "Come, you who are blessed by My Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." Skip down to verse 41. Then He will say to those on His left, "Depart from Me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels." And then in verse 46, "And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life." Listen, God is a loving God. That's why He even gives us the opportunity to respond to Him. He's God. He's Creator. He could snuff our lives out like that if He wanted to. And He's not slow concerning His promises, but His Word says He's not slow in returning. He's not slow in His promises because it's not His will that any should perish. So that's why He tarries. That's why we're here. And I ask you this morning, as we think about that picture I just described, which are you? Which are you? Have you spent your life not even maybe understanding it, but ignoring God and making your plans and preparations according to what you want and desire? Have you taken Him off His throne? Have you seen life as just happenstance? We just go through it and then we go back to the dirt and that's all I'm going to receive because I don't understand any of this other stuff. It's not worth my time even to know. Do you not have a relationship with God Almighty through Jesus Christ? Because that's how He's built a bridge. That's the answer. There is no other. This morning is the day of salvation. This morning you can repent and believe as Scripture says. Say, "God, here's my life. I give it to You. I am that person. I am in that condition. I agree with You and I need Jesus. Save me. Be my King. Be my Lord. Take my life." He'll do that today. Believer, if we've grown tired and gone into a slumber as the world burns around us and have chosen to stand back and just point our fingers and say, "That is messed up." Today, God is speaking to us. He's challenging us as a church, as individuals in the church, to look at those in our lives, our family members, our friends, our co-workers, and realize that eternal punishment is for real. And pain and heartache is for real. And it all goes back to a rejection of God. Which are you, and which are your friends and family? On that day, which will they be?